The Pentateuch, that's a good word. Let me bring this up. The Pentateuch. two. What is the Pentateuch?
The first
five books, what are they? Anyone know?
Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy.
We've got a very well-educated group here. Exactly right. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. These books are also sometimes called the Torah. The Pentateuch is Greek for five scrolls. But if we go into the historical books, Joshua, Judges, 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles. Then we go into the prophets. And then we go to the writings, which is kind of a catch-all title that includes a lot of the poetic books, such as Psalms and Proverbs. What do we call all of these together? All of these together, of course, comprise the
Old Testament.
What else can the Old Testament be called?
The First Testament
or?
The
Hebrew Scriptures or the Hebrew Bible, or what do Jews call it? Do you know? I heard it. The Tanakh. Jews call it the Tanakh. Tanakh is an acronym for Torah, Nevi'im, Torah, the first five books. Nevi'im, which is the Hebrew word for prophets, and Ketuvim, which is the Hebrew word for writings. Torah, Nevi'im, Ketuvim, you add in some vowels, and you get Tanakh. This is what Jews call their Bible. They do not have an Old and New Testament, because obviously Jews do not have a New Testament. What's the difference between the Old and New Testament? One word.
Jesus.
Thank you very much. Jesus, indeed. Exactly. Now, you might be interested to know that Christians actually have different Bibles in different traditions. We as Protestants have 39 books in our Old Testament. Catholics have more books. They have books that Protestants consider the Apocrypha or Deuterocanonical. And the Orthodox even have more books than that. So when people say, I believe that the Bible is the inerrant word of God, I say, which Bible do you mean? And they're kind of surprised, but we need to recognize there are a number of Bibles, even within Christian tradition. And I tell my students that if you ever find yourself in your imagination, perhaps, in a pay one price Bible store, let's say you were to walk into a store and all the Bibles were $10, you should go for the Orthodox section because that's the best value. Okay, you'll get the most books. The first book in all of these traditions is the same. First book of the Bible, of course, is?
Genesis.
Good. What's the last book of the Protestant Old Testament? Last book of the prophets, Malachi. Excellent, very good. Last book is Malachi. And Malachi is the Hebrew word for my messenger. And after that, you open to the first of the Gospels, which is Matthew. And there we hear read about Jesus. My messenger, Jesus, goes right into it. Let's talk a little bit about Matthew's Gospel. The word Gospel means
good news,
good. And of course, we know the four Gospels are
Matthew,
Mark, Luke, and John. They tell us about Jesus' ministry, his death, and his resurrection. Not really his life, right? Because we don't get much into the early part of his life. Mostly it starts when he begins his ministry. Only in the Gospels of Matthew and Luke do we get stories of Jesus' birth. In Mark and in John, we just start writing on Jesus' birth. The earliest gospel, does anyone know which is the earliest gospel of our gospels? Which one was written first? Not the order in which it appears. Does anyone know which is the earliest?
Probably Luke.
Actually, Luke is in the second group. The earliest is Mark. And scholars date Mark to approximately the year 70 CE. When I say CE, what do I mean? Common era, good. What's another way of saying CE in terms of a timeline?
AD.
AD, good. What does AD stand for?
Anno Domini.
Anno Domini. Anno Domini. A lot of people think after death, but it's Anno Domini, very good, which is Latin for?
Year
of our Lord. Year of our Lord. I do not use the terms AD or BC because Jesus is not everyone's Lord. And so it's more inclusive to say CE, which stands for Common Era, and And instead of B.C. before Christ, I refer to B.C.E. before Common Era. That's a parenthesis, but because right now we're in the Gospels, so we're starting with Mark. The next two Gospels, someone mentioned Luke before. Luke and Matthew, we think were written about the same time, let's say 80 or so, 80 C.E. And our final Gospel is John, written around 90 or so. So these Gospels each have different focuses, and Matthew comes first. So Matthew is not the earliest. It's not, the Bible, unfortunately, is not written in chronological order. Genesis is not the first book to be written, Exodus the second, Leviticus the third. It's way more complicated than that, sadly. But Mark is not the earliest, and it's even though it's the first. Mark is the earliest, even though it's not the first. Matthew is the first gospel. And the reason it's first is not only because it starts right with Jesus after Malachi, but it is the closest, not only physically in our Bibles, but also conceptually to what has come previously. Matthew quotes the Jewish scriptures more than any other gospel writing. What Matthew is doing is he is taking texts from the prophets, especially, and he is doing the ancient equivalent of cut and paste. He is taking excerpts from the prophetic books, and he is putting them in his gospel to say, hey, it came true. Okay. So that's what's going on. That's why we have this close correspondence. He is trying to show that Jesus is the Messiah. What does Messiah mean? We do take it to mean Savior, but actually, messenger. It's a different word in Greek. Savior comes from soterion. As you know, the New Testament is written in Greek. The Old Testament is written in Hebrew and Aramaic, 9 chapters in Aramaic. So the word Messiah means the same thing. This is the Hebrew word for Christ. They mean the exact same thing, which is anointed. Anointed. Jesus is the anointed. Christ isn't a last name, right? You know that, right? It means Jesus is the anointed or the Messiah. So Matthew is trying to show that Jesus is the anointed one of God. Now, if you're Jewish in the first century, do you think this would be an easy or a hard thing to convince people of, that Jesus is the Messiah? Hard. You are so right. It is really hard. Why?
Scams.
Scams, perhaps. Different scams, different rumors. And there were definite rumors surrounding Jesus' life. We'll talk about that in a moment. Guess why else?
He didn't meet their expectations.
Exactly. That's the hard of it. Because the Jewish scriptures talk about the Messiah. What do they say? If you look at Isaiah 11, the lion shall lie down with the lamb. The Messiah is going to come, restore Israel to its glory days, and there's going to be eternal peace reigning throughout the earth. Jesus of Nazareth comes and goes. Daily life doesn't change too much. So why do Christians believe he is the Christ or the anointed? Because there's no everlasting reign of peace, right? And there wasn't in Jesus' day either. So why do Christians believe he is the Christ?
Faith.
And the faith. But it's one particular event on which our faith hinges. What's the greatest holiday of the Christian year?
Easter.
Easter. Easter. Easter. Christmas gets the most play in our culture. But without Easter, Christmas is nothing. Without the resurrection, Jesus is just another one of those first century prophets. A good guy, doing good work. But Christians believe that Jesus rose from the dead. What happened? Who knows? But we have believed this by faith, and somehow a community of mourning turned into a community of joy. That's kind of amazing. Jews have a similar pivotal event in their history, and that is the Exodus. Yes, Passover, the Exodus. The Exodus. Both of these events, friends, we do not have evidence. Jews, we read in the Bible in Exodus about thousands and thousands of Jews trekking across the Sinai Peninsula. If thousands and thousands of people had trekked across the Sinai Peninsula, there'd be something in the sand. We don't have it. Do we have any evidence, hardcore archaeological evidence of Jesus' resurrection? Dubious shroud of Turin aside. We do not. It is, for both traditions, it is a leap of faith to believe this, to adopt this story, to claim it as your own, and to live your life accordingly. So Matthew has a very tough sell. He's trying to get his Jewish audience to see Jesus, a man, what happens to him? Crucified. Who gets crucified in ancient Rome? The worst criminals, foreign criminals, not just any criminal, foreign criminals. Is Jesus the only person to be crucified?
No.
Thousands of people were crucified. That's nothing special being crucified. Thousands of them. You're put up on this cross, nailed. There's a little seat, because without the seat, your flesh would just fall right off from the weight. You hang there, birds come, they pick at the eyes, they pick at the testicles, the soft parts of the body. It takes about 3 days, and you die from asphyxiation because your lungs finally collapse. It is a torturous, horrible way to go. The great king who comes in glory, the Jewish Messiah, is that how he's going to die? I don't think so. If you're Jewish, I don't think so. And so Matthew has a very hard case to make to his Jewish audience that this Jesus is the Messiah, and that's what he works hard to do. Let's take a look at how he opens his gospel. Matthew 1:1. I'm going to read this for you. This, of course, is the Greek, and here is the Greek transliterated. When I say transliterated, that means trans is a cross, literal is letter. I've taken the Greek letters, and I've put them into Latin characters, right? Our English alphabet is based on the Latin letters. So you can read along with me. But listen if this sounds familiar. Biblos Gineseos Jesu Christu Puyo David Puyo Abraham. Biblos, book or Bible, right? The book of Gineseos, what's that?
Genesis.
Okay, the count of the genealogy. Really, it's Genesis. You're hearing in the beginning of Matthew a reference to the beginning of the Hebrew scriptures, right? Okay. The book of Genesis. The book of Genesis. If you're a Jew, you know the Torah, the book of Genesis. Oh, this is familiar, right? The book of Genesis, Jesu Christo, Jesus. Who's Jesus named after? We'll get to that. Actually, I'm going to say that. Jesus, the Christ, or the Messiah. Quio David. Son of David. Who's David in Jewish tradition? Great king, the most glorious king of Israel. Quio Abraham. Who's Abraham? Abraham, the first of the Israelites to start the Israelite nation. Is this sounding Jewish to you? If you're Jewish in the first century, is this sounding familiar? Every single word. It's not a coincidence. This is how he begins. So let's take a look. David is the great king. And we read repeatedly in the Hebrew scriptures that the Messiah is going to come from the line of David. So if you're looking for the Messiah, start reading Matthew, and you're going to find him here. Let's take a look at how this gospel begins. So here we have this account of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah. We won't read through the whole thing. You know, people say the Old Testament is kind of boring. That just really gets me. Okay. Old Testament is fascinating, but people think the genealogies are boring. The genealogies, these lists of sons of sons of sons, they're not boring, but they require time. They require time. I'll grant you that. It's not an easy narrative to read. But when you look really closely, there are fascinating discoveries. And I want to try to convince you of that with the opening of Matthew's gospel here. So here we see this account of the genealogy, Jesus the Messiah, son of David, son of Abraham. We won't go through all of this, but I want to point out a couple of things. First, we have four women who are named in this genealogy. That's unusual to have women named in the genealogy. Who are they? We've got Tamar. Tamar is a woman who disguised herself as a prostitute. There are two Tamars, but this is the Tamar who's referred to in this verse. In Genesis chapter 38, we have Rahab. Rahab was a prostitute in Joshua chapter 22. We have Ruth, who was a Moabite, who came to Boaz in the middle of the night and had this child with him. And then we have the wife of Uriah, who's Bathsheba, whom David had an adulterous affair with. What do all these women have in common? somewhat sketchy sexual past, right? Why would Matthew put that in? Was Mary married when she was pregnant with Jesus? So what is Matthew doing? Oh, you know, there are rumors, scams, rumors going around about Mary and her dubious reputation. Don't worry, we got that covered. It's part of our history, we're proud of it. I'm going to write it down to just remind you of it here. So you see, this genealogy is not boring at all. And look, it comes to Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, to whom Jesus was born, he's called the Messiah. These are very interesting names, just note them, we'll come back to that. All the generations are 14 generations. And the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. And from deportation to the Messiah, 14 generations. Why 14 generations? Problem here, if you take the time to go back to the Old Testament and you trace all of these genealogies, it's not 14 generations. It's not. Matthew has left out names on purpose so he can get the number 14. Why does he want the number 14? Let me show you. The Hebrew letters. In Hebrew, when you count, each letter has a numeric value. So Aleph is 1, Gimel is 2, Aleph Bet is 2, Gimel is 3, Aleph Bet Gimel Dalet is 4. Aleph Bet Gimel Dalet Hey, Vav is 6, and Dalet is 4. So if you give those their numeric value, you get 4 plus 6 plus 4 equals 14. Dalet, Vav, Dalet spells David. Are you with me? Do you see what's going on here? So Matthew, with the 14 generations, is trying through numerology, which was very important in Jewish mystic circles, to get across this idea that this is David. He is coming from David. He's related to David. So the messianic promise of David is fulfilled in Jesus' birth. Another reason for the 14 generations. So you see how thoroughly Jewish this gospel is? And we're only all Jewish names in the first chapter. And we're only through this first chapter. But it's also the names of the people in Jesus' family. So Jesus and his family, let's talk about the names. Jesus, he is named, who's he named after in the Old Testament? Does anyone know? He's named after Joshua. Very good. Ben was my student. Okay. Named after Joshua. Both names, Jesus is named after Joshua. Both names mean, you know what the name Jesus means? It comes from the Hebrew word yasha, which means to save. To save. So Jesus saves the people from their sins, and Joshua delivers the people to the promised land. Poor Moses never makes it to the promised land. And Joshua delivers them there. So the name Joshua and Jesus means he saves or he delivers. And we have Jesus' mother, Mary. Of course, who is she named after in the Old Testament? She is named after Miriam. Who is Miriam?
Moses' sister.
Good. And if you read some Greek manuscripts, the name actually has a final mu at the end. It's not Mary, it's Mariam. Mariam, like Miriam, Moses' sister. And then we have Jesus' father, Joseph. Who is he named after in the Old Testament? Joseph, the guy with the coat, remember? Not your question. Joseph is named after Joseph. Amazingly, I was able to get actual photographs of all of these people. And there are these correspondences as well. We see here with Matthew, the birth of Jesus is told in this way. So as the story goes on, after we get the genealogy, we pick up with the rest of the chapter. And it talks about all of this. And just as he was resolved to do this, so we talk about the sketchy sexual stuff. So let's say the rumors have been swirling. Matthew doesn't shy away from it. He embraces it. Yes, that's what happened. It's part of the story. And look who's part of the story as well. Joseph, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. What is Joseph known for in the Old Testament? What does he do before Pharaoh? Interprets the dreams. So these connections, if you're Jewish, in the first century and you're reading Matthew's Gospel, or you're hearing Matthew's Gospel read, more likely, very few people could read in the ancient world. It was a luxury. You just focused on surviving every day. Literacy was unnecessary. And so, interestingly, in Hebrew, the word for to read is the same as the word to proclaim, kara. Because if you can read, you're proclaiming something. So if you heard this proclaimed, you would hear all kinds of echoes of what is going on within the Old Testament in this gospel that Matthew is presenting. But Matthew does not stop there. He keeps going and talking about how Jesus is a fulfillment of everything that has come previously. And here we see this cut and paste. Would someone read this for us, please?
Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us.
We all know this verse, right? We all hear this at Christmas time. Interestingly, the word for virgin here in the Hebrew is alma. It does not mean virgin. It means young woman. There is a word for virgin. It's betulah. That is not the word here. But when the Hebrew got translated to the Greek translation of the Hebrew scriptures is called the Septuagint. When the Hebrew got translated to the Greek, the word parthenos was used here, and that meant virgin. So it comes down again and again as virgin. A lot of scholars debate this, because even if she was a virgin when she conceived, like, let's say, you know, a lot of people, that they don't have sex before they're married, you know, especially generations prior, it's standard, really, that people would be a virgin, women would be virgins when they first got married and conceived their children. And so there's nothing in here about perpetual virginity, but it does talk about this virgin. But this translation, you should know, is very, very contested. And even when the RSV, the Revised Standard Version, in 1952 was published, and they had the word young woman instead of virgin in this verse, there were public burnings in Mississippi of the Bible because of this verse. Because of this verse, which comes from Isaiah 7:14. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, the young woman, here it is with young woman, is a child, and shall bear a son, and shall name him Emmanuel. So Matthew is taking Isaiah. Matthew is working from the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible. So he reads Parthenos, virgin, in the Greek translation, and that's what he puts in his translation. It's like me. I can read the Bible in Hebrew, but I usually read it in English because it's a whole lot easier, right? He could probably read it in Hebrew too, but he would read it in Greek because that's what he's writing in. It was a whole lot easier. There are lots of instances where we see Matthew doing this cut and paste. Let's take a look. Would you read that first verse, please? Thanks so much.
In view, Bethlehem in the land of Judah are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.
Thank you so much. So here we have this. We know this. We know that Jesus is born in the little town of Bethlehem. This actually comes from Naomi. If you look back at the book of Ruth, she's from Bethlehem, and then it's through Ruth, and then Ruth marries Boaz, and then they have Jesse, and then we have Obed, and then it goes into the Davidic line. Obed, Jesse, David. And so here we have, so Bethlehem. Do you know what Bethlehem means? Bethlehem. Beth is house, and Lehem is bread. House of bread. So it's from House of Bread, and this comes from Micah 2. Can I have a volunteer to read this for us, please? Greg, would you read this for us, please?
But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are one of the little clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from old, from ancient days.
So here you see what Matthew's done. He's gone back to Micah, he's taken that verse, and he's put it into his gospel. Let's look at a few more examples. Here we go.
Sure. On entering the house, the child feared his mother, and they knelt down and paid homage to him. Then, opening the treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh.
We all know this, right? We're in Epiphany time now. This is the story of Epiphany. How many kings come bringing these gifts?
Three.
How many does the Bible say? It doesn't. It just mentions the three gifts. So we know there are multiple kings. In Greek, they're called the magi, which is from where we get the word magic ones. The magi, those who can do wondrous things like read the stars or astrologers. And so the three of them come, it's in the plural. All we know is three gifts. So it could be that there's one of the magi per gift, or it could be that there are two of them because it's multiple, or it could be that there are 30 and they've all chipped in. Okay. But notice where this comes from. Take a look. Can I volunteer to read this verse for us, please? Would you guys?
A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord.
Okay, so here we get these are the gifts that are going to come. Gold, we don't see the mark here, but still he's drawing on the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah is the prophet whom Matthew quotes the most. Let's take a look at a couple more examples. Here we go. Volunteer, please. Thank you.
Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." Then Joseph got up, took the child and his mother by night and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I have called my son."
Okay, thank you so very much. And we mentioned this, but let's take a look again. Genesis 48. Someone might read this first, please. Would you pass?
They said to him, "We have had dreams, and there's no one to interpret them." And Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Please tell them to me."
So here we see Joseph as the interpreter. Does Joseph in the New Testament speak? Can you think of anything that he says? The father of Jesus, you'd think he'd be pretty important. Does he speak? Doesn't say a word. Joseph, does Mary speak in the Bible?
No.
You bet she does. Mary has the Magnificat. "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit sings for joy in God my Savior." She talks about the rich being sent away, the lowly being lifted up. Perhaps Jesus got his radical politics from his mother. You go, and you take a look at that. And I hope, do you do a Christmas pageant here at Messiah Lutheran? Yes. Well, I urge you when you do your Christmas pageant to please consider giving Mary some lines, because they're in Luke's gospel. You don't have to make them up. She says a lot in the Bible, and they're important words, actually based on the Song of Hannah in 1 Samuel. But here we see this correspondence again with Joseph and the dreams. But in this passage, it's not only that Joseph is being compared, Joseph, Jesus' father, who doesn't speak so as to not upstage God as the father of Jesus. He does not speak at all. But we also see Jesus being compared to somebody else who's very important in the Old Testament. So here we have a child who is born to Jewish parents. And there's a fierce, so we have a child, okay, we have a Jewish boy. And there is a fierce tyrant out to get him. Who's the tyrant?
Herod.
There's a fierce tyrant out to get him. And the child and his family flees where?
Egypt.
Egypt. And the child is protected. And then comes back via the wilderness. And eventually this person delivers God's law. Does this sound familiar? Moses! Jesus is the new Moses, fleeing the tyrant, the child's about to get killed, goes down to Egypt, and comes back. So here we see correspondences again. I'd like to turn now to Luke's gospel and just show you, there's one more, Matthew 2:18, I'll read this. "A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing in loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children." That's after this whole incident with Herod and the slaughter of the innocents, all the children he's trying to wipe out, potential rival, just as Pharaoh does, wiping out all the baby boys in Exodus 2. "She refuses to be consoled because they are no more." This actually comes from Jeremiah 31:15. "Thus says the Lord, a voice is heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping. Rachel is weeping for her children. She refuses to be comforted for her children because they are no more. Again, Matthew is making these correspondences very explicit. I'm going to go to a little clip here. Talk among yourselves. I'll give you a conversation topic. Rhode Island, not a road, not an island. Discuss.
Does that sound like something a mother would say? You bet it does, right? What have you been doing with the words?
Why were you searching for me? Didn't you know I must be in my father's house? Does that sound like a cheeky thing a 12-year-old might say? It might, right? And they didn't understand. He went down with them, came to Nazareth, was obedient. She treasured these things in his heart. Jesus increased in wisdom and in years and in divine favor. What he said in that movie were the words from Malachi, about turning the last verse of the entire Bible shall turn the hearts of the children to the parent and the hearts of the children, parents to the children. So the end of Malachi, that was the filmmaker's decision, but I think it was a good choice because it shows again this connection with the Hebrew scriptures. What did you think of this video? Is that how you would imagine the scene? Any thoughts, comments, reactions? Yes, please.
It won't take up too much time. I'm more interested in hearing from you, but I wouldn't have thought women and men were in the same place in the Jewish temple.
That's a very good point. No, I wouldn't think that they would be. That's true. That's true. It's a very good point. What did you notice about Jesus' family?
More children.
More children, right? There was a brother and a sister. Where does that come from? Does Jesus have brothers and sisters?
Probably.
He does. Mark 3:32. A crowd was sitting around him. They said to him, "Your mother and your brothers and sisters are outside asking for you." So this video shows the brother and a sister. Yes, please.
Perhaps they were half brothers and sisters.
That's true. That's a possibility. It's very possible. They may have been. And some scholars think that's why we don't find Joseph in any stories of Jesus as an adult. Some scholars suggest that he was older, that he had died at that point, and that there may have been siblings, you know, from a previous marriage. It's very possible. We just don't know. But we see Jesus in the temple, perfectly at home. And so I'd like to wrap up with a few final thoughts, then we'll have some questions, and then take a look at the scroll. But what I would like you to take from this evening primarily is realizing, as we know, that the Gospels are the foundation of our Christian faith. We're all aware of that. And Matthew is the first Gospel because it follows the Hebrew Scriptures so closely. Not only is the writer of this text dependent upon Jewish Scriptures, but he goes out of his way repeatedly to make these connections explicit, as I hope I have convinced you this evening with this evidence. Friends, in a world where so many forces seek to divide religious peoples into groups that oppose or even hate each other, I think it is a moral imperative to recognize how much our treasured scriptures bind Jews and Christians as sisters and brothers in faith. For our Bible, both the Old and New Testaments rely on Jesus' scriptures because Jesus was a Jew for his entire life. Indeed, if every time we said the Jew after we Christians say Jesus, I think there would be a whole lot less anti-Semitism in the world. And I also think that Jesus, the Jew, would like that. Thank you very much.
Right.
Sure, the earliest writing, I won't go into too much detail, but writing was invented by the Sumerians around the 3rd millennium BCE, about 3,000 years before the birth of Jesus. And they took the materials that they had, which was clay and styluses, reeds, and they would press them into clay, first to make pictures. Eventually those pictures became stylized to create sounds, to represent sounds, and eventually it led to an alphabet. But the our ancient Hebrew texts would come from this area that we know as Israel or Canaan, that general area, and they did not have clay there in abundance the way they had at the borders of the Tigris and Euphrates. And so they would write on parchment. Do you know what parchment is? What is parchment?
It's different kind of paper.
It's animal skin. It's leather. So you would take the animal skin and you would scrape off the flesh, and then you would treat it and you would stretch it, and that's what you would write on. Vellum is the skin of a cat. It's fine parchment. It's the skin of a calf or a calf fetus. Well, and there are, if you look at medieval books, there are all kinds of laws about where the tanner who created the parchment could live, because it smelled so bad. I mean, you can just imagine. And the inks would be natural inks, natural dyes, and it would take a lot of effort. I mean, imagine if you wanted to write the story of Messiah Lutheran Church, your faith community, and you don't have any papers or pens, let alone computers, right? What would you write with that would last? It's an effort. It's really a lot of effort and expense. So
you get a scroll like this.
Here's
if you
a
go
scroll.
To the synagogue today, you will see this. But this was back in biblical times, so they wrote on animals.
They did.
And put the five books.
That's right.
And this is
a parchment scroll.
So this is a parchment scroll. we'll see if we end up.
You can see where little insects have eaten in here.
Brilliant.
When does this date from?
Well, I think this is probably 2 or 3 centuries old, I would say. So this is the whole book of Esther. So you're studying Esther, so you're seeing an Esther scroll. Now, the first five books of the Bible, the top of the Torah, you'll see in the synagogue, and it's read through weekly. But Esther is read in Purim, so it's coming up, right? during Holy Week this year, the 23rd, the 24th of March. So we're trying to, in this class, it's something that's speaking right to our time in the synagogue. So on the 23rd of March in the evening, the celebration of Purim begins, and it's all based around the Esther story. So we'll be reading Esther instead of that. We can show people but it's a carnival atmosphere. So we had Bob Lane here from the Columbus Jewish Federation last week, so he said that it was a carnival atmosphere at which you could drink as much as you
supposed to get drunk during Purim.
Right.
It's almost a rule.
So anyway, tomorrow morning at men's breakfast, if you want to talk about how we could celebrate Purim in Holy Week, make a proposal to the test. No.
So why do they still pay for gray?
Yeah.
Did you say that it was just a few centuries old?
This.
Share the bus?
So this Torah itself is probably about 2 to 3 centuries old.
So they still make them out of scrolls for tradition, obviously.
That's right. They make them out of parchment, and the people, the scribes who write it, it is a spiritual vocation. They pray before they write. Torah scrolls in a synagogue are revered, and they are cherished. They are handwritten. And when it is worn out, it is no longer usable, do you know what you do?
That's very
bury it. You have a bury.
So it's like a human being.
So is that why the Dead Sea Scrolls were found that they've been buried?
Yeah, so that's perfect. Right to left, right? Both the pages.
The Dead Sea Scrolls they found that were buried, or that, is that why they were buried?
The Dead Sea Scrolls, I've got a question here. I'm just going to say a little about the Dead Sea Scrolls while you walk
by. Okay.
The Dead Sea Scrolls were found in the winter of 1946 to 1947. There was a Bedouin goat herd, not a shepherd, because you need flat grassy pasture for sheep. It was a goat herd named Muhammad al-Din, who was, there were these caves, and he was looking for a goat, and he threw in a stone, and he heard, 3 days later, he went back. He was really excited. He saw all these jars. He took his staff, started smashing them, thinking, gold, silver, rubies. What did he find? Something far more precious. Scrolls dating from the time of Jesus. From 170 BCE to 70 CE. 900 scrolls have been found, or fractions of scrolls, in all of these 11 caves that eventually end up being excavated. They were high up, they're really inaccessible, and that's what, and they were in the desert, very arid land. That's what enabled them to survive in thousands of years.
So it's beautiful.
Does that answer your question?
Yeah, yes. I just wondered how, if there was any speculation of how they got
there. Well, there's speculation, there are different theories, but what I think, quite a few scholars would agree with me, that these scrolls were produced by a quasi-monastic community located in Qumran, which is where the scrolls were found. And because archaeological excavation has revealed a layout of large rooms and inkwells, which I think was a scriptorium for copying them, and large baths, which is a mikvah. Some people say it was a rich person's home. That's the other debate, but I don't think so, because of the evidence that's been found. And so when the Romans were coming, they feared that they were going to be destroyed, which they were. And so they took their scrolls, which were so precious to them, and they hid them up in the caves in the mountains. And they stayed there for thousands of years.
So I'm glad we had a little discussion. She could have a whole course, you know, studying just the media that the Bible was written.
I think it's also, thank you so much for bringing this story. I think it just helps us to appreciate how precious these materials are and how much dedication it took to write, to preserve these stories, and also, honestly, that these stories come from really the cultural elites, because these are the ones who have the resources to write. And given that, it's actually amazing that so much of the Old Testament and the New Testament, they're folk literature, right? You read a lot of literature of the ancient Near East. Let's take Egypt, for example. You go to all those pyramids, you read the inscriptions. Who are they about?
Kings
and queens, right? The tombs of kings and queens. You go to Mesopotamia, you read all those, the different, a lot of the stelae that we have, the big stones that are inscribed. It's all about the kings and their conquests and things. Not about, you know, Joe Abraham. Yeah, he had a lot of money, but he wasn't a king. He didn't have a lot of power. He didn't have a lot of political power, much less Moses. He's bicultural, but he doesn't have a lot of money either. And so it's really, it's just amazing, I think, these stories that we have. And I tell my students, there are things in life that will disappoint you. Friends, job interviews, lottery tickets. But this text will never disappoint you. Everything you give to it, it will give back to you with great and lasting interest. Remember that.
Yes, yes. Years and years ago, I took a class and it showed how, when they used the parchment, how precious it was. So they ran the words all together, and this professor had a paragraph where the words were all run together, and we were given the sign of figuring out what it said. And almost everybody had a different interpretation of which letters went where, as to what it said. Is that something that was factual? I guess it was, or she was being teaching.
No, that's right. She's absolutely right. And it can change the meaning. If you look at our earliest copies of the New Testament, for example, the letters all run on and on. They're all capital letters, you know, small, lowercase letters help us to read. But look at this, for example. If I write, No space. What does this say? God is now here, or God is nowhere. You all depends where you put the spaces. You see how that could change the meaning? God is now here, God is nowhere.
And this text is unpointed, so it doesn't have the vowels. There are some consonants. The way they're used, you can kind of figure out the vowels, but you can take all the vowels out of that.
That's right. That's right. And then it's that's
what
mark.
This text.
That's right.
Could you explain to the audience a little bit about assonance and how they change the way the Jewish scroll is read?
Sure. The Masoretes, those are the transmitters of the text. And in our earliest scrolls, as Ray's pointed out, you don't have the vowels. People just knew it. Really, it was like a prompt. It was like if you're looking at a hymnal, you know your hymns really well, right? So sometimes you just kind of look at it as a prompt, and then you sing it out. It's just kind of a reminder. That's how people read then. They knew a lot of it. They had it memorized. It's largely oral culture. And they would glance at the text to kind of remind them. But what happened over time is people started forgetting how these words were pronounced because language changes over time in a place. We mentioned before the Bible was written in Hebrew and then Aramaic and then Greek because the language of that same area, Israel, Palestine, changed over time with the various empires. And so the ancient Jewish scholars were very concerned that people were forgetting how to say these words and because the language was changing. And so they started putting in dots and dashes and things, like this word, for example. Can I read that? Shalom, shalom. But in Yeshuvim, it's shalom, shalom. It could go a lot of ways until you put in this. So the Masoretes put in this and this. And if you know Hebrew, you know that this tells you that this is a sha, and this is an O sound. So instead of shalom, sholom, shulom, you know to say shalom. So the Masoretes around the 4th, 5th century CE put in these markings so that people would know how to pronounce the words. Yes, please.
What does shalom mean?
Good question. It means really wholeness is the best translation, I think. Wholeness, completeness, the goodness in totality. Peace, it gets translated, but it's just, I think wholeness captures it a little bit better. How is your home? And you say in modern Hebrew, mashlomcha, mashlomech is how are you, gets translated. Mashlomcha is to a man, mashlomech is to a woman, but it literally is like, what is the wholeness of yours? How are you doing? Yes, please.
Linguistic question. You said there were markers there to indicate the pronunciation of vowel sounds, but are there markers for accentuation or stress so that you know to say shalom and not shalom?
If you see it in a verse, yes. If you see it in a verse, but yes, there is. If you see it in a verse, there are all kinds of markings. There are cantillation markings. For example, if this were at the end of a phrase, you'd get this, which is called an atnach, and that means that you've got a pause. Or you get, yes, so you do have those. That's how people have a copy. Yes, please.
When Mr. Lane was there last week, he made a point about Jewish bar mitzvahs and education as a cornerstone of Jewish life. Mm-hmm. In Jesus' time, did they have a thing like a bar mitzvah? Would it have been an oral tradition?
I don't know of bar mitzvahs in Jesus' time, but I'll confess, you're out of my territory. New Testament's like practically modern times. But they do, I don't know about a bar mitzvah then, but the word bar mitzvah, how do you say son in Hebrew? What does bar mitzvah mean? Like a mitzvah is like a blessing.
A different word than
the man. Right, a bar. You know what bar means? How do you say son in Hebrew? Ben. Bar is son in Aramaic. So that would lead me to think it might be a little bit of a later tradition. There's a book by Ivan Marcus called On Jewish Ritual, and that we know for sure. So I think that in Jesus' time, it's more this learning in the temple and the education that people are getting. But I don't know that I can't think of any for prescribed ritual that's taking place along the lines of what we have today. That's that formalized. Yes, please.
This is a real basic question that I've always wondered about. So before the temple was destroyed in 60-whatever CE, they had synagogues in villages before that, but the synagogue culture that we have now never developed until after the temple was destroyed. Is that true, or?
They had synagogues, which were a synagogue. Synagogue is sin, is with, like sympathy, and ogog is people, like sympathy. So it's, actually demography is not a good example, but you know, it means people. So synagogue is with people. And so you get these, so it's the same as ecclesia, which is with gathering. So it's just a gathering. There was one temple that was in Jerusalem that was built by Herod, and it was huge. It was the size of multiple football fields. It was a complex. It was just huge. You know, thousands and thousands of people worked building it. And then it only existed for a short time, less than a decade, and then the Romans destroyed it. And so, but during this time, there were lots of different synagogues, which were local places that people worship, you know, in their local towns. So you'd have the synagogue, and then the big temple was in Jerusalem.
So they always had, so, not always, but
they would
but
have
Jewish
synagogues, yes. It wasn't one of the, like the temple would be, like going to Jerusalem today, you know, that was the really exciting place. And but there are lots of different communities of worship.
So every village would have,
they would.
Would have some sort of local gathering.
Would come together and read the scriptures and discuss them. I mean, and they're in the synagogue, they're in the Holy of Holies, and you have the action. Yes, all this. Yes. Any questions? Well, thank you so much for taking the time to be here. It has been my joy to spend this evening with you, and I thank you so very much for having me.
Palestinian scene.